Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to worship with Eliot Unitarian Chapel. You know, this is the first Sunday that I am saying these words live all year. So if you are tuning into our service from whatever device or whatever means, through Zoom or through Facebook or through YouTube or on our webpage, let me know you're here. So give me a like if you're on Facebook, or some kind of reaction if you're on the Zoom call. But let us know that you're here. I am so glad that you are with us this morning. And I am Eliot's lead minister, for those of you who don't know, Reverend Barbara Gaydon. And we are continuing this experiment called Pandemic Church with a live service the first Sunday of every month. We're excited and maybe a little bit nervous. And welcome. If you are new to Eliot Chapel, we are an intentional community that welcomes all races, genders, all sexual orientations. We welcome people of all creeds and beliefs, all economic circumstances, and all types of families. Our vision is to create a just world through vibrant, beloved community. If you would like to connect with us and learn more about our congregation, please look for information at the end of the service. Our opening words are by the Reverend Karen Johnson. Ancestors who spoke with bravest fire, lend us your senses, that we may know another world is on her way. Forebears who led the way where there was at first no way, lend us your persistence, your temerity, your assurance that the moral arc of the universe does indeed bend towards justice. May the good company of these spirits surround us all who are gathered now in the flesh. May we give of ourselves that the common stones now in our hands might be cathedrals of compassion today, and halls of restorative justice tomorrow, and sheltering walls of beloved community in the days beyond that. It's Sunday. We're here together. Let us be thankful and full of praise, sensing the spirits of the ancestors and savoring the company of one another. Come, let us worship.
In the Unitarian Universalist tradition, we light a chalice to symbolize that we are entering sacred space and preparing ourselves to give and receive the blessing of beloved community. We light this chalice, symbol of our purpose to bring more love and justice into the world. We light this chalice knowing that our congregation as a church dispersed across communities is not bound by walls, but connected through the web of life.
Please join us in singing hymn number 44, We Sing of Golden Mornings.
We sing the heart courageous, the youthful eager. Hello, everyone. Now is the time for all ages on Sunday, February 7th, and the story today will be narrated by me, Heather Flick. Today's story is called Treasure Stones, written by Janine Grossmeyer. In a time not so long ago, there lived a boy named Arthur Lismer. Arthur had always had a pencil in his pocket because he loved to draw. He drew clouds, he drew birds, he drew flowers. He drew many beautiful things, and he drew pictures of stones. "Why are you drawing a boring old stone?" his friends would ask. "They're just rocks." "Well, stones are beautiful," Arthur had told them. "Just look. Some stones have gold flecks. Some have tiny crystals. In the rain, a stone can change color. In the sunshine, it could sparkle. Every stone is a treasure. Every stone is beautiful. Just look." Arthur would draw pictures anywhere, anytime. He drew in the morning at the breakfast table. He drew during lunchtime at school. He drew on moonlit nights outside, surrounded by the trees. He drew on train rides through the countryside. He even drew on Sundays at the Unitarian church he had attended. When Arthur was 13, he went to a school just for artists. After he graduated, he sold his drawings to some people. When he was 26 years old, Arthur decided to leave England and sail across the Atlantic Ocean all the way to Canada. Trees, flowers, and animals in Canada were all new to Arthur. He traveled to many places, going to the mountains and the prairies and the lakes and the rivers of the great land, painting pictures of things that he saw. People liked his pictures. They liked seeing the world through his eyes. And most people hadn't traveled very far, and Canada is a very big country. Arthur's pictures were like windows into a new world. And in his pictures, people could see a river of snow flowing down the mountainside. They saw trees with great gnarly roots all twisted together. They saw a church and houses surrounded by fields of grain. They saw gray rocks colored bright red by the setting sun. They hadn't seen that before. They realized just how magnificent Canada was. "Just look," Arthur said. "Look and see." Many people bought Arthur's pictures to put in their homes. People put his pictures in schools and in offices, and even on postage stamps. 5 years after Arthur came to Canada, he became a teacher at an art school, showing people how to create art. On Saturdays, he taught lessons and classes in a museum for people of all ages. And on Sundays, he taught children at his Unitarian church. "Let's go outside," he would usually say. "Let's see what we can find. Let's see." "Stone," a child said one day. "It's just gray." "Let's see," Arthur said. He licked his finger to get it wet. And he rubbed his finger on the little stone. The stone turned pink. And then purple, and then gray again. "It's like a rainbow," the child said. Arthur took out his pencil from his pocket. He always carried a pencil and drew two small tiny dots on one end of the stone and then a long curving line on the other. "It's like a mouse," the child said. He turned the rock over so they could see all the spidery lines in the cracks. "It's like a map," the child said. The sunshine came in and the rock began to sparkle. Now it's silver and gold, the child said. It's like a little treasure. It is a treasure, said Arthur. The child nodded, holding tightly the stone that was a rainbow and a mouse and a map and a treasure. It's my treasure stone, the child said. I can see that now.
What kind of treasures do you see? Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the service. Hello, everyone.
So I would invite you to join me in the spirit of prayer and meditation. And because we are on Zoom, we have the opportunity also during the prayer, during the moment of silence, to share something that you would like to hold up in prayer. So you can open the chat box and during the silence, just type in if there's somebody you want to lift up, if there's some situation you're concerned about, this would be the time and place to do it. And you can also speak it aloud, just stay on mute, but you can enter your deepest prayer into this space. So please join me in the spirit of prayer and meditation. Blessed are we who gather with open hearts together in this space today. Blessed are we, the chalice lighters of resistance, justice, love, and faith. Blessed are we, the heretics, the outcasts, the walkers of our own way. Blessed are we, the border crossers, the refugees, the immigrants, the poor, the wanderers who are not lost. Blessed are we, the transgressors, the trespassers, the passers-by, the cause takers, the defiant, the compliant. Blessed are we, the hand extenders, the sign makers, the protesters, the protectors. Blessed are we, the trans women, the trans men, the non-binary, the cisgender, the multigender, the no gender. Blessed are we who rise in solidarity. Blessed are we who cannot. Blessed are we who do not. Blessed are we who rise as a friend, the stranger, the lonely, the hidden, the visible, the authentic. Let us enter into a time of silence for the meditations, prayers, and blessings deep in our hearts. For all these prayers and those held in the privacy of our hearts, we offer our blessing. Blessed are we, for this is our beloved community, and this is who we are. Amen. At Eliot Unitarian Universalist Chapel, we have a long-standing tradition that we share our Sunday collection with our partners in the community who are also working to the same shared values that we have. In the month of February, we are sharing our plate with Home Sweet Home. And I'm so pleased to have Betsy Resnicek here with us. She's the executive director of Home Sweet Home, and she's going to talk to us a bit about what Home Sweet Home is and why it's so important. So tell us about Home Sweet Home, Betsy. What do you do and why is it so important?
Yeah, thank you so much for your past support and your ongoing support. Home Sweet Home is a nonprofit furniture bank. So what that means is that we take donated furniture and household items. We put it into a big warehouse here in Brentwood, but then we partner with about 40 different organizations who refer clients to us. But it's not just about the furniture at Home Sweet Home. Our mission is to really give people dignity and pride in their lives. We happen to do that through furniture and household items. And so all the donations that we take in, We take a lot of care to make sure that they are really clean and they don't have any rips, tears, stains, holes, something that can give the clients a lot of, you know, pride and something that they can be excited about receiving. And traditionally, the clients get to shop and come to our warehouse and pick out those items. Now with COVID, we've actually moved the online process, the shopping process to an online process. So again, still trying to keep that dignity and pride piece in there. So instead of coming to the warehouse, we want to make it as safe as possible for our families and for our staff. And so we've moved it online, just like you and I like to go online and shop.
Yep.
We take pictures of all the items, we put it online, and then our case managers spend a lot of time walking through those pictures, talking about what their space is like, asking them a lot of questions, so that helping the client pick the right items for their space. And just like before, we still deliver it to our clients' homes. So our clients are all over St. Louis City and County, but they don't have a lot of resources to be able to pick up these furniture items, now let alone lift it 3 flights of stairs, right? So we have movers that we pay to do this every single day. Right now we're serving about 17 to 18 families a week. And since we've been doing this for 5 years, we've served more than 2,200 families. And so your support helps make sure that we can keep those trucks running, that we can pay staff that really care about the families that we're serving and treat them with dignity and pride during this process. You know, keep the gas running, the lights on, all of that stuff. We each family ends up getting a whole apartment worth of furniture, right? So they're getting kitchen tables and kitchen utensils and a bed to sleep in. And so when you donate, whether you're donating furniture or you're donating resources like money, it's all going to make sure that we can give little kids a bed to sleep in and parents that dignity of being able to give their kids dinner at a kitchen table, just like you and I do.
Thank you so much, Betsy. And I'm so glad that we can partner with you and be part of living your mission.
Thank you so much.
Kind friends all gathered round, there's something I would say. Then what brings us together here has blessed us all today. Love has made a circle that holds us all inside, where strangers are as family and loneliness can't hide. You must give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. I've walked these mountains in the rain. I've learned to love the wind. I've been up before the sunshine to watch the day begin. I always knew I'd find you, though I never did know how. But like sunshine on a cloudy day, you stand before me now. So give yourself to love, if love is what you're after. Open up your heart to the tears and laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Love is born in fire, it's planted like a seed. Love can't give you everything, but it gives you what you need. Love comes when you are ready. Love comes when you're afraid. It will be your greatest teacher, the best friend you have made. So give yourself to love. If love is what you're after, open up your heart to the tears and laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. If love is what you're after, open up your heart to the tears and laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to
love. Our reading this morning is by Ralph Waldo Emerson. It's a passage from the Divinity School Address. In this refulgent summer, it has been a luxury to draw the breath of life. The grass grows, the buds burst, the meadow is spotted with fire and gold in the tint of flowers. The air is full of birds and sweet with the breath of the pine, the balm of Gilead and the new hay. Night brings no gloom to the heart with its welcome shade, though through the transparent darkness, the stars pour their almost spiritual rays. Man under them seems a young child and his huge globe a toy. The cool night bathes the world as with a river and prepares his eyes again for the crimson dawn. The mystery of nature was never displayed more happily. The corn and the wine have been freely dealt to all creatures, and the never broken silence with which the old bounty goes forward has not yielded yet one word of explanation. One is constrained to respect the perfection of this world in which our senses converse. How wide, how rich, what invitation from every property it gives to every faculty. In its fruitful soils, in its navigable sea, in its mountains of metal and stone, in its forests of all woods, in its animals, in its chemical ingredients, in the powers and path of light, heat, attraction, and life. But when the mind opens and reveals the laws which traverse the universe and make things what they are, then shrinks the great world at once into a mere illustration and fable of this mind. What am I and what is? Asks the human spirit with a curiosity new kindled but never quenched. So ends the reading. To be ignorant of what occurred before you were born, writes Cicero, is to remain always a child. For what is the worth of human life unless it is woven into the life of our ancestors by the records of history? To know our history is part of what it means to grow up. It also means that you get to spend time with the ancestors, with people who wrestled with the same things that you do now. To know what choices they made and what it cost to make them. It is to find your tribe, your people, and to have a fuller and richer sense of who you are. So, once before we were born, we were called Transcendentalists. It was the 1830s, and we were Unitarians living in New England. We were young and getting restless with the corpse-cold worship of our parents. They taught us to use our minds, to use reason when reading the Bible, but what if you wanted to learn more about the world and about the divine than just in the Bible? There was a young preacher that everybody called Waldo, only he wasn't a preacher anymore because he didn't have his own church anymore. We didn't know, he left his church, and we don't know if it was because he lost his wife, dear Ellen, so young, only 20, she died of tuberculosis. It was sad, and it could have been that, but there were whispers that he also would not serve communion. He didn't believe in it. I mean, we were already in trouble, Unitarians. I mean, we were already radical. We were the halfway house to infidelity, someone wrote. But Waldo Emerson was going much, much further than that. And one hot July evening, it was 1838, the seven graduating students from Harvard Divinity School invited him to speak at their commencement. The chapel was crowded, maybe 40 of us jammed in there. We counted ourselves lucky to have seats. All of us came because we knew that Waldo was going to say something scandalous. We young ones were excited about that, and the faculty, our elders, sat there grimly, disapproving before he even began. Well, so be it, we thought. You may have already heard his opening words. In this refulgent summer, it has been a luxury to draw the breath of life. The grass grows, the buds burst, the meadow is spotted with fire and gold and the tint of flowers. What was the problem with that, you might ask? Well, you just wait. In that speech, he started to say all the things that we were thinking. How tired we were to just keep hearing only lessons from the Bible. We are alive now, we thought. We have hearts and minds and life now. He was saying that the miracles in the Bible were nothing compared to the miracles that we experience in our lives all the time in the blowing clover and the fall of rain, he said. That everyone was divine, Jesus no more than the rest of us. That everyone had a soul that was just innately moral, that it was wise in and of itself, and it was connected to one great vast soul that holds everyone and everything together. You just had to know it and bring it forward and trust it. God is not some big person out there in the sky. God is not a person at all, but something inside us and around us and in nature. The air is full of birds and sweet with the breath of pine, he said. This is our religion. And suddenly, religion, faith, spirituality, oh, I do not care what you call it, was alive again. It was alive. The elders were so shocked and so angry. They said, Ralph Waldo Emerson may never come and speak in this chapel again. After that, many things happened. Teddy Parker decided he was going to start a church based on these ideas. He called it absolute religion. And they didn't kick him out, but there were a lot of us who were not supposed to talk to him. And Waldo. Well, after dear Ellen died, Waldo inherited her fortune. He had to sue her family because she died before she turned 21. Can you imagine? But he decided that he would live in Concord and bring his like-minded friends to live there. They would become a community. There was Henry, who could always use a bath, if you asked me, but we liked him. There were the Alcotts. They were forced to close down their school in Boston because Mr. Alcott Bronson decided to teach children where babies came from. They made him shut the school down right after that. They all left. Waldo liked Bronson and decided to rent a house for him and his family. I felt a little sorry for those four Alcott girls. They got so thin on a vegetarian diet, and they froze in the winter wearing only linen because their parents wouldn't allow wool or cotton. Wool because the poor sheep, and cotton. Well, we shall come to that later. At the Emerson House, there was a frequent guest, Miss Margaret Fuller. He once said that she made him laugh more than he liked. She was certainly there a lot more than his new wife, Lydian, liked, I will tell you that much. She was beautiful and the smartest woman, maybe the smartest person I had ever met. She could not go to university. None of us girls could in those days, but her brothers taught her everything that they were learning. And when the Transcendentalist Club met, that's what they started to call it, the men would have these amazing conversations about philosophy and theology and history and nature, and Margaret, she kept up with every one of those men. But she noticed that the women were not really saying anything, so she decided that we should have conversations of our own. We got a room in Mrs. Peabody's bookstore, you see. This is where all the radicals in Boston went, writers and organizers. I heard tell that there was a place here that was something like it. Mokabees, I believe it is called. Margaret taught us how to argue and debate. You had to put yourself out there. You had to say what you thought. If you were shy, she would have you put your ideas down on cards, and she read them out loud. She taught us to think. She wrote this book called Woman in the 19th Century that everyone was reading. It questioned everything we'd ever heard about what women and men could do in this world. Margaret was also a journalist. We were sad when she went off to Italy to cover the revolution for the New York Tribune, but we were so proud that we knew her. You know, once you decide to start thinking for yourself about what is true and that everyone is divine, it creates a sense of a higher law than the laws of the land. And this creates a lot of trouble. Women are divine. Children are divine. Slaves are divine. We lived in New England, but we knew about slavery. We knew it was wrong. We knew that it was evil. Not all the Unitarians felt that way. I am very sorry to tell you. We knew people who owned, and some of us were people who owned and worked in the textile mills. They weren't going to give up that livelihood. Vice President John C. Calhoun even said that if we gave up slavery, we would stop being a great country. And he was Unitarian. We were so ashamed of this. And then something changed. In 1850, President Millard Fillmore, also a Unitarian, signed the Fugitive Slave Act. And this meant that even if you lived in the North, as we did, and you saw a runaway slave, you must help capture that slave and return them to their master in the South. And if you did not, you would pay a fine of $500. I believe that is worth $33,000 in your money to the in this time. And you would spend at least 6 months in prison. Waldo called this law this filthy enactment. And he said he could not believe it was made in the 19th century by people who could read and write. He said that he would not obey it by God. There was a higher law than that. What were we to do? At first, some of us thought that we should encourage everyone as individuals to look into their conscience, to reflect on the divinity of every person. Surely it would end with that. We knew that we had to do something. Teddy Parker's church was hiding a couple. Their names were Mr. and Mrs. Kraft. They were two people who had been enslaved and escaped, and they were now members of his church. Mrs. Kraft, Ellen, lived in his basement. And they said that when he wrote sermons, he kept a pistol on his desk and a sword on his wall if he had to defend her. if anyone came looking. But even though his friend Frederick Douglass was telling former slaves that they should stay in the United States and work to end slavery, Teddy and the others came to see that it was too dangerous for them to stay, and they helped them get to Canada. Some people say that Teddy was one of the secret six who supported John Brown and his violent insurrection to end slavery. What would we do? What would end this terrible thing? Would we risk violence? These were terrible questions. Many of us were pacifists, but the more we fought slavery, the harder slavery fought us back. Goodness, there was so much money at stake. They would never give up of their own accord, these plantation owners. The day they recaptured in Boston, they recaptured poor Anthony Buehrens in Faneuil Hall and returned him to Virginia. Many of us were there. There was a mob trying to prevent it. It was a scuffle. It was terrifying. I have a scar. Modesty forbids me, but I will never forget. I had to be there. You come so far, and you have to, you know. We knew that there was going to be war. And with heavy hearts, we supported it. Do you recall a book that I told you about that Miss Fuller wrote, Woman in the 19th Century? Well, there was this young woman who read it. And when she read the passage that said, women can be anything, sea captains for all I care, she thought that that could also mean doctors. Women could be doctors. And if no medical school in the United States would allow her to study here, she would go to France, and she did. She became the first woman doctor in the United States. You might have heard of her, Elizabeth Blackwell. She heard her Transcendentalist preacher say that conditions for soldiers were so unsanitary that they were dying more from the filth in some places than they were from getting shot. Elizabeth, that is to say, Dr. Blackwell, mercy, it feels so delightful to say that regarding a woman, does it not? Dr. Blackwell helped to lead a group to organize the Sanitary Commission. Today, you would call it the Red Cross. Oh, mercy, how long I've kept you. I have only a few questions to ask, and then I shall end. Might you be a Transcendentalist? Do you believe that all are divine? Do you believe that nature, above everything, is to be honored and respected? What are you being asked to do in your divided time? Amen.
Please join me in singing hymn number 318, We Would Be One.
In us is true.
Now may the love which overcomes all differences, which heals all wounds, which puts to flight all fears, which reconciles all who are separated, be in us and among us now and always. Amen.